Thank you. My talk today is about one of the commonest fracture in children. It is the lateral condyle fracture, which accounts up to 20% of elbow injuries in childhood. It is well covered actually in the literature, this fracture, but unfortunately still challenging. And the most controversy is in the diagnosis and treatment. Actually, the problem usually we face is the classification of this fracture and to decide which one is to be treated surgically or not. One of the well-known classification of lateral condyle fracture in children is Melch classification, which is designated at 1964. It is based on the fracture location through the epiphysis. Unfortunately, it is not predictive at all in the for outcome or suggestive of the treatment. However, it is mostly cited in the literature, this classification system. Jacob in 1975 described two types of the non-displaced or minimal displaced fracture. Usually the problem lies in the minimally displaced fracture, whether it will further displaced or re-displaced after conserved treatment. Jacob said that if there is cartilaginous hinge here, this means that the fracture is stable and there will not be further displacement of this fracture if it is treated by cast. The other one is an incomplete fracture, but there is no cartilaginous hinge, and this fracture is prone for further displacement. Song et al. In 2008 designated a very comprehensive classification, which is linked to treatment algorithms, but we found it a little bit difficult to be used in emergency situation. And all of us know that this fracture usually treated in the emergency or as emergency. Most authors now believe that the best way to classify this fracture is to measure the degree of displacement. And they classified it into three types, non-displaced or hairline fracture, minimally displaced, the fracture, the displacement below 2 millimeter in measurement, or displaced above 2 millimeter. However, this to make the 2 millimeter differentiation between minimally displaced and displaced, it is not agreed by most of the authors. And there is a big controversy between the authors about this, which is considered minimal displaced or consider it displaced. And also, for minimal displaced fracture, it is prone to redisplace again or further displace. This is the area of controversy. Many attempts are done for to differentiate between the fracture prone to for further displacement or not. And this includes arthrography, MRI, and ultrasound. But most of these attempts are either invasive or expensive. And the little surgeon use them in emergency situation also. There is agreement that the minimal displaced or non-displaced fracture is treated by non-surgical treatment or by cast. And the displaced fracture treated by surgical fixation, whether after closed reduction or open reduction. However, which one to consider displaced and minimally displaced? We come back again to the main problem of this fracture. Actually, the risk of subsequent displacement is up to 42%, which is very high. And this will lead to delayed surgery. And this is the problem. If we do late surgery, this will cause avascular necrosis due to the stripping of soft tissue during mobilization of the fragment to reduce it. That's why some investigators recommend to fix all minimally displaced fracture, and this will actually some children will be exposed to surgery unnecessarily if we fix all the minimal displaced. This is not logic. So our study is aiming to recognize the impact of further displacement on the minimal displaced fracture and to define the fracture displacement. This is the most important thing, is the displacement definition. So we can find the fracture which necessitates primary surgical intervention, and to ascertain also which fracture need early follow-up to avoid delayed surgery. Our inclusion criteria include that all children had lateral condyle humeral fracture between 2004 to 2010 with complete information and the radiographic examination, and they all of them have to have at least 4 years of follow-up. We excluded from our study all children which had associate injury of the same limb or neuromuscular disorders that affect the rehabilitation or affecting the final assessment. All these factors must be fulfilled during our data collection. We are, as authors, reviewed blindly all the initial radiographs. And we used our clinical practice pathway of pediatric lateral humeral condyle in our institute, which defined the hairline fracture as non-displaced, fracture gap with less than 2 millimeter as minimally displaced, and the fracture gap more than 2 millimeter as displaced fracture. And we assessed our patient at the end of the follow-up using the Cardona et al. 2002 modification of the Hardacre function rating system by adding the radiographic assessment to assess the healing of the fracture. We had 98 children enrolled in this study, 67 boys and 31 girls. The age ranged between 3 to 10 years. Right elbow was involved in 38 patients and the left in 60. During initial assessment, there were diagnosed of 7 non-displaced fractures, 29 minimal displaced fracture, and 6 displaced fracture. We can find here the non-displaced and minimal displaced fractures are much less than displaced fractures. This because some of the fractures which treated by conserved treatment were not following our orthopedic clinic. They were treated in the emergency room and they followed them there. 63 of our patients were treated by primary internal fixation within 24 hours from the injury, and 8 of the of our patients were found redisplaced. Actually, all these 8 from the second group, the 29 minimally displaced fracture, and they were treated by delayed surgery. 52 patients had an internal oblique radiographic view during initial assessment. 49 of them had displaced fracture, and 3 had minimally displaced fracture. During our statistical assessment, we found that there is a significant association of the author's assessment with the initial assessment. Our assessment retrospectively during making this study, and the initial assessment which done when the patient came to the emergency room. We found that the author assessment is significantly associated with the initial assessment, specifically in minimally displaced fracture, where 7 of the minimally displaced fracture out of 29 were found to be displaced, not minimally displaced. And there were mistakes in classification of these children as the diagnosed as minimally displaced, but they were, we found them displaced fracture. Also, there were significant association between open reduction both minimally displaced and displaced fracture. We can find that we usually use open reduction more than closed reduction. The mean cast time for all of our patients was 5.1 weeks. The average follow-up was 50.2 months. We encountered 5 superficial infections at the site for entry, which all of them healed readily with only wound care. 21 children underwent a rehabilitation program. 5 of them have to have an extended period of intensive physiotherapy. We found only 4 poor results among our patients. All of them were minimally displaced fracture according to initial assessment. Three of these poor results were displaced according to author assessment. So only one is minimal displaced according to author's assessment. We found three variables, specifically the initial assessment and the time from injury to surgery and the casting period were significantly associated with the final outcome by crude analysis. All our bore results were treated by open reduction and internal fixation. So there is significant association between bore result and open reduction. There is no bore results with closed reduction or non-operative treatment. Our result actually highlighted the significance of each initial assessment. Most of our poor result due to failure in initial assessment and inadequate treatment. Subsequently, if there is no accuracy of the classification, subsequently there will be inadequate treatment. We found also that standardization of the classification with the use of all the radiographic views and considering the internal oblique views, this will lead to high quality of diagnosis and subsequently good decision making for treatment of this kind of fracture. We also concluded that the fractures with 2 millimeter or more than 2 millimeter is considered displaced. Not only the more than 2 millimeter, it is also with equal 2 millimeter or more. And usually we have to measure the displacement in all radiograph views, AB and lateral, here in AB and lateral and internal oblique. And we found that it may be different. Usually in the AB, there is the displacement, the measurement of displacement is the less. Usually in the lateral, internal oblique view, it is the more. We can find here in AB view, it is only 1.86. Here it is 2.666. This means that we have to measure the displacement in all views and to consider the displacement as the one which is more. The internal oblique views, actually now it is well established that it is very important to be used in initial evaluation of lateral condyle fracture. Some people recommend to use stress radiographs, MRI, and arthrography, and others, but each one has inherent drawbacks, and I don't think that can be used in emergency situation. Only in certain situations, like in children less than 2 years of age, we can use arthrogram, for example. Most complication, as we said, it is associated with operative treatment, but most of them is minor. Major complications will lead to substantial functional loss. That's why we have to avoid it. And we found that to avoid complication, it is better to avoid delayed surgery. So the key to obtaining satisfactory outcome is to avoid delayed surgery and to determine properly the displacement, which view is the match displacement there, and then we decide for the treatment after that. The other thing to avoid further displacement after starting conserved treatment is to to see the patient in a proper time to avoid postponing surgery if there is further displacement. And we found that during the follow-up, we don't need to remove the cast to improve the quality of the X-ray because the displacement can be seen through the cast. And if it is found any further displacement, then we can shift to surgical treatment. Three areas of controversy there, whether to use closed reduction or open reduction, whether to it is mandatory to do anatomic reduction for all fractures, and to use two or three KORs for fixing this fracture. The first issue, closed or open reduction. Actually, we didn't find any difference significant difference between closed reduction and open reduction. Some fractures are treated by closed, some fractures cannot, and it is better to do open reduction for them. But we recommend that don't spend too much time for closed reduction. It may be time consuming. If it doesn't come from the first shot, then convert directly to open reduction. Anatomic reduction is mandatory. It is a physical injury, and we have to reduce the fracture anatomically. But this in fresh cases. In delayed surgery, better to align the arm only, then fix it. Otherwise, it will we have to do too much stripping of the soft tissue, and this may lead to vascular necrosis. Many authors talk that the use of 3K wires will cause osteophyte formation, and this can affect the motion of the elbow, but we didn't find this in our study. The 2K wires also can cause some osteophytes, as in this case, but the results are equal in both conditions. In conclusion, we conclude that the careful initial assessment using the internal oblique view, in addition to the standard X-ray views, is crucial to adequate treatment. And the fractures, if the fracture is equal or more than 2 millimeter in displacement, where it is better to treat it by primarily internal surgical fixation. However, if the fracture is less than 2 millimeter, and it is now minimal displaced fracture, it must be reviewed after 4 to 6 days. 4 days, so we will give the chance for further displacement if it this time to occur to be okay to be appeared in the follow-up X-rays. If it happens, then we go for surgical fixation. We better see them before 6 days, so there will no delay in the surgical fixation, because most of the poor results usually occur if the fixation delayed after 1 week. Thank you.